About the board, well, you have to be able to see me. See me. All right. Stand by. So, for those of you that are watching at home, it's a great day for America. We've just finished up with an election. I'm happy with the results. Welcome to CRT workshop number 7. So, the question, the way this happened is I saw somebody posting a symptom on the Facebook page, and the list of possible causes was insane. The things that people speculated might be wrong to cause this issue, I can't even remember specifically what it was just absolutely insane. Some of it just, most of it just completely off the wall. And again, there's this obsession with the flyback transformer. Oh, it must be your flyback. It's always the flyback.
Yeah, you gotta watch the advice on Facebook and the forums.
No kidding.
People give a lot of bad advice on those places.
Really, just awful. So I made the comment, gee, there's a lot of bad advice there. And somebody else responded, well, what's the answer? And I said, well, I think I'll address this at the next CRT workshop, which is now. But apparently it wasn't that interesting to most people, or they're out dancing in the street or crying in their beer or something. So anyway, so one of the things that I want to talk about now today is something known as power supply ripple. Power supply ripple. R-I-P-P, power supply ripple. And what I'm talking about now is strictly for what we refer to as the linear type of power supply. A linear type of power supply is also referred to as a conventional power supply, meaning that it's just an ordinary kind of power supply that works off of 50 or 60 hertz, the kind that we've been using for 100 years. It really hasn't changed in 100 years, a normal power supply. I am not talking about switched mode power supplies that are in the monitor or the low voltage power supplies. I am strictly talking about this old school linear 60 cycle per second power supplies. So that's what I'm talking about. And I'm talking about bad capacitors, bad filter capacitors in the power supply. And for some reason, people have trouble determining the difference between whether it's a 5-volt power supply that has the bad capacitor or if it's the monitor that has the bad capacitor. So my goal here is just not to tell you quickly how to tell the difference, because I could do that in about 30 seconds. My goal here is to kind of show you a little bit about how this works so that when you encounter problems, you can think them out for yourself and kind of figure out what the heck is going on here. So let me think how the best way to approach this is. Let's start with how the monitor works just a little bit. Not a whole theory of operation of how the monitor works, but kind of how it works. And that's a pretty awful monitor drawing. Where's my eraser? Let me try that again here. In fact, let me make it bigger. So there's something that looks kind of like a picture tube. And as you know, the picture itself is made out of lines, and the beam itself, the electron beam, moves from left to right across the screen and draws a single line of the picture. And then it draws one line after another. As the beam gets lower and lower on the screen, it fills the screen with these lines, which are known as lines of raster. They're called raster lines. It actually comes from the Latin word rastrum, which means to rake. And you'll see as the electron beam kind of rakes across the screen, if you can imagine putting a rake into a sandbox and just drawing straight across it, you'd end up with these lines, wouldn't you? So it's called a raster scan monitor, and it makes these lines. Well, it makes a whole bunch of these lines, and in a kind of a standard definition video game, it makes 240 lines or so. And it takes, and this is the important part I'm getting to, it takes 1/60th of a second for the beam to move from the top of the screen to the bottom of the screen, drawing one picture on the screen. It takes 1/60th of a second to draw one picture on the screen, which is known as a field. One complete pass on the screen from the top to the bottom, filling the screen full of these horizontal raster lines, is called a field. So it makes 60 fields every second. 60 cycles per second, 60 hertz, is the frequency of our vertical deflection, also known as vertical sweep, S-W-E-E-P, vertical sweep. So that's the same frequency as our AC power here in America, isn't it? 60 hertz. It does not depend on our AC power to get that 60 hertz. It's generated internally inside by a circuit that we'll probably look at in one of these days. But anyway, so that's how long it takes. So with that in mind now, let's move to a power supply. Let's move to the standard kind of 5-volt power supply that you find in any old asteroids or any of these old games, not switching power supplies. So the way those power supplies work is that the AC power comes in, and of course it goes through a fuse first, and that's the schematic symbol for a fuse. And then it goes to a bridge rectifier, as you know. And the bridge rectifier can be made of 4 individual diodes, or it can be made of a single one-piece bridge rectifier. It doesn't matter how you do it. In some cases, there are 2 diodes, and we'll talk about that a little more in just a little bit. So one side of that is grounded typically, and what goes into the bridge rectifier is alternating current. It's a sine wave that looks like that, a sine wave. It's called a sine wave, S-I-N-E-W-A-V-E, a sine wave. So what comes into this thing is the sine wave that looks like that. Sometimes the sine wave is positive and sometimes it's negative. But the bridge rectifier inverts the negative half of the sine wave. And what comes out of the bridge rectifier right here is, and I'm sorry, I'm drawing a graph here that shows time, sorry about that, in the horizontal direction versus voltage in the vertical direction. Same graph that an oscilloscope draws. Anyway, what comes out of this thing is this. In other words, where it used to go negative here, that bridge rectifier has flipped the bottom of the sine wave up, and now we have only positive pulses, but they drop to 0 volts every 1/120th of a second. That is one cycle of alternating current. This is super important now. This is one cycle of alternating current. This is 1/60th of a second. Get where I'm going with this thing. So this is also 1/60th of a second. It takes 1/60th of a second for the beam to move from the top of the screen to the bottom of the screen. And it also takes 1/60th of a second for one complete cycle like that. However, they are not synchronized with each other. Super important concept. The AC power, the sine wave that comes from the wall receptacle, is not synchronized to the same frequency, the 1/60th of a second. That's the vertical deflection, or again, it's called vertical sweep. It is the same frequency. It's not a coincidence, but the monitor doesn't depend on AC power to get that 60 hertz. It's generated internally by a circuit that you don't have to know about right now called the vertical oscillator, but they're not synchronized with each other. Okay, so this period of time right here is the same period of time as from here to here, but they are not synchronized. Now, the point of the filter capacitor, the capacitor, the biggest capacitor in any of these power supplies, and of course it goes right here, like this. The purpose of this is to filter out the peaks and valleys. The purpose of the filter capacitor is that it charges up when the current coming out of the diodes is at its peak voltage. And during this time period here, where it drops to zero, the capacitor, which is now charged up and kind of like a battery, keeps the current constant at a constant voltage until the next pulse comes along and sort of tops it up. So what we end up with is this straight line that we've been kind of looking for. It's DC. A straight line, as you know, is the graph of direct current. It never changes voltage. It's always the same polarity and so on. So the filter capacitor is supposed to do that. However, here's what happens. As the filter capacitor fails, it allows the voltage to drop down in between pulses like this. The voltage drops down in between pulses. And instead of it being a straight line, it looks like this. We call this power supply ripple. It's called power supply ripple because when you look at it with an oscilloscope, it looks like a rippled line like that. So it's called power supply ripple. It is also sometimes referred to as power supply hum, because if this happens to be driving an audio amplifier or some audio system, you'll hear a noticeable hum from the speaker, you know, like that. Mm-hmm. So like on your home stereo, if you hear a hum coming from the stereo, you either have a bad capacitor in the power supply, or it might not know the words to the song you're playing and it's just humming.
Sometimes.
Tip your waitress. Okay, so anyway. But my point is this, that it is now going to drop out. The voltage will drop down twice every 60th of a second. That's a 60th of a second. So we get two dropouts in a 60th of a second. All right, so here's what happens. As you know, the way a monitor works is that you have the logic board here, and coming out of the logic board, and I won't get my colored pens because you understand this. There's a red signal and a green signal and a blue signal that come out of the board. And of course, those are the video signals, the three colors, red, green, and blue, primary colors of light. And all these are, as you know, are just changing voltages. It's about somewhere between about 0 volts and around 4 volts or so, maybe even 5. And the higher the voltage, the brighter that color is on the screen. So that's how video works. The higher the voltage, the brighter that color, red, green, or blue, appears on the screen. Well, get to wrap this whole thing up. One of the things that you see sometimes is something known as hum bars. Remember, power supply ripples also called hum, power supply hum. And when you see hum bars, you will see two dark areas like this. You see two dark areas because remember, it drops out twice every 60th of a second, and it takes a 60th of a second for the beam to move from the top to the bottom. So you see two hum bars, and the more it drops out, the wider the hum bar is. The longer it drops out for, the wider the hum bar is, and the hum bar is a dark region because the voltage has dropped a little bit. It hasn't dropped enough that the chips don't work, but the video is very sensitive. If you have just a fraction of a volt difference in the video input voltage there, you'll see a noticeable change in the brightness on the screen. And the other clue is they will be slowly moving up or down the screen because remember, they're not synchronized. Yes, it's the same 60 hertz, but it's not synchronized with the AC power coming in. Therefore, you see two of the bars, but they are typically slowly rotating up or down, or rising or falling up or down on the screen. And in that case, you know when you see hum bars, it's a linear power supply, 5-volt power supply that powers the chips on the board.
Hey, Dustin.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Yep.
Hey, did anybody else come in? Or are we still just three?
We had two people come in.
Hey, hi, two people, whoever you are, I'm not seeing.
Dustin and John came in.
Hey. Oh, hey, John.
Hey, Randy.
Okay. Did you have a comment? Sorry.
Yeah, I used the link that you gave on the most current link for the Zoom, and it doesn't work. I went back to a previous link that you posted, and it worked. So I posted the new link, and I think hopefully, yeah, it looks like Dustin got in as well.
Okay, yeah, oh boy. Somebody, I ought to make somebody else the host from now on to be easier. Stand by. Wow, what the heck is that? What? No, no children, please. Thank you.
Randy, I got a question for you.
Yeah, all right.
Out of all the monitors you worked on, how many filter caps have you come across that were actually bad?
Hardly any. The primary, the filter capacitor in the power supply, the main primary filter capacitor, hardly ever fails because it's only working at 60 hertz. There's one thing that you really should note about electrolytic capacitors, and that is, let me sit down for a sec. Let me change cameras. Stand by. Whoa. Really? There we go. Hey. Where was I going with this? Sorry.
Filter cap.
Oh, sorry. It's high frequencies that really gobble up filter capacitors. When what we call the ripple frequency is really low, and 60 cycles per second, 60 hertz is really low, or 50 hertz, depending on where you live, it doesn't eat up those capacitors very fast at all. The higher the frequency, the more likely you are to lose capacitors. That's why when you have filter capacitors that are on flyback derived power supplies, typically these are electrolytic capacitors that are near the flyback, they're just kind of around it. Those are way the first things to go because those are operating at high frequency, either 15,750 hertz or 25 kilohertz. They're operating at high frequencies. Same thing when you have a switched mode power supply. The primary biggest giant high voltage capacitor or capacitors might fail. It's not very common, but guaranteed the output filter capacitors, the ones that are on the edge of the power supply right by wherever the output connector is, they're all built that way. Those are the ones that fail because the switching frequency of a power supply like that is 30 kilohertz, 50 kilohertz, you know, some high frequency like that. So you should be aware of that. And that's kind of why in these workshops, I kind of would like to get people to understand what's going on here and how fast things are working or how slow they're working. So you know where to go when you have problems. So you can just say, oh, well, I've never worked on this before, but this is definitely high frequency crap. Oh, I'm definitely going to look at this part first. And remember that my shtick is to try to find the actual bad part rather than just shotgunning a whole bunch of caps, which I've done. I'm not saying don't do it. I'm just saying it's more rewarding to figure out what is bad. And so that's one way to look at it. If it's high frequencies, those caps, number one, they're likely to fail. And number two, you better have a high quality cap to go in there. We talked about Nichicon capacitors, N-I-C-H-I-C-O-N, Nichicon. Let me see, where's my chat here? Whoops. Oh God, I don't even know where chat is in this thing. I feel like an idiot. Oh well, Nichicon, N-I-C-H-I-C-O-N, Nichicon. That's really odd. I got to play with this before I do one of these things.
That should be at the bottom of your picture there.
Oh, there it is. That's right. Yeah, I see it. I didn't mouse over it. There we go. Hey,
I have to say, for the monitors that I've done over the years, the only ones that have a higher failure rate, not even that high, are the old Nintendos, the old Sanyo EZ20s. They seem to have a higher filter capacitor failure than all the other classic monitors for some reason, which I don't know. But typically, if I'm working on a Sanyo, I might be more inclined to replace a filter cap than any other classic monitor.
FYI, during that era, Japanese and in fact all the Asian capacitor manufacturers didn't have a very good handle on their electrolyte chemistry. Not like Sprague and these United States companies that really had a better handle on the chemistry itself for the electrolyte. And then that changed a bunch of years ago now, but that changed in 1990, probably, really, where I don't know what happened, if they hired some white dudes to go over there, some Caucasian Americans to go over there, or whether they figured it out. I don't really know. But they changed the chemistry. And so now modern capacitors like the Nichicon brand, they're fantastic. And I always go for Japanese stuff, but I'm kind of a Japophile, I guess you'd say. You know, I had some sushi for lunch last night, and I don't know. I've never really been walking around Japan. I've been to Japan, but not really.
Randy, have you seen this on the Sanyo? I'm sure you've rebuilt plenty of Sanyos over your time. That the capacitors just like to explode, or the legs blow off of the Sanyo EC20s quite often. I don't see that on any other old monitors except the Sanyos.
No, and you know what? Don't forget, it's 40 years old. So, you know, you blow your top too if you were 40 years old. Well, maybe you will blow your top, and you are 40. I don't know. So,
I had a question about aluminum polymer capacitors. I've been looking at those for some cases where the other electrolytics aren't exactly readily available. They have amazingly low ESR. They've been in the market for about 10 years. I wonder if anybody's had an experience with those.
Personally have not. No. I've done ceramic caps on surface mount devices, but not the polymer.
Is there a price difference on those?
They are slightly more expensive, and the range of capacitance and voltage is smaller. But it's kind of a new technology. I'm looking at it and I'm thinking maybe I might want to use, or they say they're drop-in replacements. I'd be interested.
As opposed
to 30 cents, you're looking at maybe 75 or something. But like I say, the actual ESR value on those things are supposed to be just incredible.
I wonder if I don't know the answer to this, but somebody was mentioning ESR in the news group. I mean, the Facebook page. I can see where high ESR would be a big problem, but I wonder if the ESR was too low, if that would ever be an issue, like in a timing circuit or something, not necessarily as a filter cap, but I wonder.
One of the questions of what I'm thinking is like, where would ESR play a role in what part of the circuit?
Yeah, I'm not enough of an engineer to really be able to quantify that. Not really. I mean, I know we definitely need low ESR caps in the higher frequency circuits for power supplies, but how it might affect coupling, AC coupling capacitors or bypass caps or any of that, I really don't know. Let me move on though, if that's okay. Is everybody cool? Let me move on to the monitor part of this discussion. So hang on one sec. Let me just change cameras and we'll go back to the board here. Okay, let's stand by. All right. So that's the low voltage power supply. That's when the 5-volt power supply fails, you get the humbars. But it doesn't change the geometry of the picture. Doesn't really change, pull in the sides or do anything. The sides stay pretty straight, and that's not your issue. On the other hand, when the capacitor fails in the monitor, and this is pretty easy to understand here. Let me just draw some kind of a CRT. Gosh darn it. You'd think after 40 years of drawing a CRT, I could do it. All right. That's the best. No, it's not the best I can do. Come on.
Come on, Randy.
I know. I should just have some kind of a template. The sides of the raster are supposed to be perfectly straight. When you're working on a monitor and you want to adjust it, make certain that you turn up the brightness control, typically the screen pot on the flyback transformer or some other brightness, so that you can just barely see the raster, so that you can see, you know, where the raster is and is it square and all that kind of stuff. But when the main primary, when the main capacitor, the filter capacitor fails in a normal monitor, it allows the voltage to drop. That's the symptom of a bad capacitor. When a capacitor fails, instead of keeping the voltage constant, it allows the voltage to drop down. And again, remember, it drops two times in a 60th of a second, right? 1/60th of a second. So what happens in this case is, as the power supply in the monitor, the B plus we call it, drops in voltage, it causes the sides of the picture to pull in. So it pulls in like this. Why? Because the voltage is low. If the voltage is low, it doesn't have enough voltage to completely fill out the screen. It will be a little shrunk this way too, but that's easy. That would be easy to adjust if you did, which you won't. But it pulls in like that, and it pulls in twice on the screen. And again, because it's not synchronized with the vertical sweep, it does the hula. And you see it doing two hulas because it drops out twice. You see it pull in twice, and these hulas are slowly going up or down the screen. Does that make sense? Because it's the power supply in the monitor that's bad. Make sense?
Yep. Cool.
Now, here's one other weird thing. I was going to mention it previously, and I totally forgot about it. So my bad. Let's look at Pac-Man. So the way Pac-Man works is that it has what we call a center-tapped transformer. And it has on the board two diodes. It is a full-wave power supply. It's two diodes connected like that with their cathodes tied together. And one of these goes to that, and one of these goes to that. And this is the low-voltage transformer. And then on the board here, also there's the filter capacitor, which is that 8,000 microfarad capacitor, an axial lead capacitor, you know, that's on there. Anyway, so what happens in Pac-Man very often, as you know, is the connector burns. And so you might see one hum bar here. On Pac-Man, you might see just one hum bar because the other diode's gone completely. And again, that one hum bar will roll up or down. If you see one hum bar, it simply means you have like a bad fuse or a bad connector, because there's a fuse here and a fuse here. And if one of them are blown, it does the same thing. And I imagine you've all seen that. I imagine some of you.
Plenty of times.
Yeah, okay. So the way I always fix that, by the way, and you may, there's a couple of different ways. One is that they do have copper foil and you can really rebuild the edge connector. But what I really do is solder one wire here, one wire here, put a two-pin connector on it, solder a wire here with the other half of the connector on it. And then I just put those things together. That way the edge, the card edge, remains the same. You haven't modified that at all. And you could still put the connector on, but it adds an ancillary power connector. It's not a bad idea to do that anyway, even before you have failures.
So, that's awesome.
You know, just a two-pin amp connector. And, you know, that's something that is a field repair. Remember, I'm a kind of a field service guy. And so, you know, that's something I would just carry with me.
I think Namco did that with their pole position boards as well. When Atari's get burning out all the leads on the connector, they went to a point where they connect them separately into the board.
Ah.
Yeah. I just happen to know that because I have one.
Cool. So anyway, that was the only thing I actually had planned to talk about. If you got something else you want to talk about.
So was that what we saw? I think it was the Space Invaders, right? Where the guy was seeing that sort of deflection within his monitor?
Yeah, I'd have to go back and look at it. Now, for some reason, the only thing that stuck in my brain was to talk about the difference. I can't remember which he had.
Really. I
remember now. I asked that I wanted the brightness turned up a little bit so I could see it, because it looks all wiggly, but I really can't tell exactly what's going on.
It looked like it was droopy in the center to me. Not like it was a hum bar or a hula, but more like it was drooping in the center.
Well, remember, it's turned sideways. So,
oh, that's a good point.
And really, it kind of looked to me like it was going bigger, smaller, but once you look at the size of the raster, you can see, if you'll see the whole raster pulling in, you know what the deal is, that it's a monitor power supply that's bad.
While you're talking about the Pac-Man machines, have you, Randy, seen the just slow black bar going across the screen and a hum associated with it? Have you seen that failure?
Wasn't that what I just discussed? One single hum bar that moves across the screen?
I thought you were talking about the Hula as well.
No. I said I wanted to step back for a second. I should have discussed this when I talked about power supplies first, the low voltage power supply. Yeah, the single hum bar can only happen when you have a center tapped power supply, the one that uses the two diodes and the center tap transformer, and one leg is not working right. That's the only thing that can cause that.
Installing a switching power supply instead of the transformer would be a quick fix for that, would it not? I have a Galaxian that somebody hacked in a switcher, mm-hmm. and they just bypassed a transformer and they cranked it up.
That's what I would do. I would never run, if I was running it, let's say as a commercial operation, I would never run it with the original stuff in it. Mm-hmm. I would absolutely throw a replaceable switcher in it so that when that switcher does fail in the field again, I could just throw in a new power supply and be done with it. Yeah, I have no problem with that whatsoever. I've even kludged together like several power supplies. Like sometimes I needed a minus 12, didn't have it. Grab another power supply, ground the plus 12 output of it, and the ground becomes minus 12. There's your minus 12. So, you know, once you learn a little bit about electronics, it's pretty easy and fun to do that kind of stuff. That's entirely possible to do. I hope that wasn't too confusing. Anything more?
I have a sound issue in one of my games. If we could go to a Spy Hunter for a second. I had a switcher I installed in it because I wanted the linear power supply wasn't working correctly. So I got the best switcher available and installed it, and it worked horribly. I would get the game would work, but I would get horrible background buzzing noise. I bought the best one available at the time.
Wow.
And it couldn't handle it, so I had to rebuild the linear power supply. Stick that back in. Now it's quiet and perfect, but I couldn't get a nice power supply, a nice switcher to work on it.
Is it possible that, I mean, you have a scope. Did you scope the 12-volt output of the power supply? Was it full of noise? Was it wrong? I mean, that's, I'm guessing where it came from, the 12-volt, right, for your audio amplifier.
This was before I even had a scope. I've had this sit-down Spy Hunter for years and years. So I just ended up rebuilding the linear power supply and put it back in and worked great.
That's a massive board. It's a massive board, isn't it? And the power supply, I can't recall, but
three-stack board.
A pair of series pass regulator transistors, a pair of 2030 and 3055s or something on there. I can't really recall how that's set up. We're going back 40 years now, so
yeah. I don't even remember. Yeah. It works great now. I'm just curious why a switcher wouldn't work. That I heard that from several collectors that switchers don't work.
Switchers, switching power supplies are extraordinarily noisy, and by noisy I don't mean noise that you can hear. I mean electromagnetic interference, or EMI as it's called. That's why they have so much filtering in them. But even with all that, the amount of noise coming out of a switch mode power supply is humongous, and the chips themselves, the digital logic, they're immune to that kind of noise. That doesn't bother them at all, which is why the game works. But of course, any little audio, any noise on the audio, you'll hear. And mm-hmm. so that's, for some reason, your 12 volts probably output of the thing is really shitty. Or some output is really super noisy. It would have been interesting to try some other power supply in there and see if it was just that one supply.
I tried a cheap power supply. Then really? I went to an upgraded power supply, and they did the same thing.
Yeah, so, I could not disagree with people that say that switchers don't always work. They might not always work for that reason, mm-hmm. that reason alone. I mean, you know, I'm a big proponent of just trying stuff out. It's a bit different when you're a hobbyist and you can't afford to just spend $60 on trying something to see if it works. But, you know, You know, people say, well, will this work? You know, will this transistor work in there? Well, I don't know. Try it. See, it'll either catch fire or it won't work, one or the other, you know, or it'll work.
Actually, I think I was working at GeoCivil one time, and I gave you an email. You replied pretty quickly to it. And it was something about a fuse in there, and you're like, yeah, bypass it and see what happens.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, they call that the smoke test. I usually don't like to do that. But in the case of the GeoCivil, you do that, and you watch the flyback explode, and you go, oh, wow. You know.
You did give me all the proper, this could happen, that could happen.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But I like the approach of, hey, sometimes this is what you have to do to make it.
Hey, right. Look, we're not doctors, even though I guess I play one on TV. You know, we're not. And our patient, if it dies, it's not really that big a deal. You know?
Exactly. If anybody else has a question, I have a quick one.
Okay.
Well, maybe it's a quick one. I don't know. So I'm working on a vector monitor.
Oh, yeah. And
high voltage gauge here. So okay. You can kind of see that. Where the flyback attaches to the high voltage diode, that whole connector was, I don't know if it was heated up and burnt out or it just disintegrated.
It disintegrates. It gets all sticky and decomposes.
Yeah. What's sort of the best way to kind of...
You just got to cram them together. That's real high voltage there. It'd be hard to keep them from connecting. You know, as long as they're really near each other, you're probably pretty much okay. There is something that you should know about. There's two things. There is anti-corona tape and anti-corona dope. Anti-corona. Corona is, for crown, is the high voltage discharge. It's not an arc, but it's that blue hissing sound you hear. You see a blue a spark, but it's not like an arc, like an orange arc. It's blue, and you smell ozone as well. It generates ozone. So it's called anti, that's corona. So there's anti-corona dope, D-O-P-E it's called. You put some in the bottom of a paper bag and just inhale it. About three huffs. And then when you're good and dopey, you paint it on whatever's arcing. But the best stuff is this tape. They've got this tape, and it's, you just peel an adhesive, a plastic covering off the adhesive back, and you smush it on, and it melds into itself and makes a solid rubber high voltage shield. Just look for it.
Would you solder everything together and then just put that over that?
Well, you don't ever solder the high voltage
diode.
I wanted to say stick for some reason, the high voltage diode. You just would push them together and tape them together with this anti-corona tape. It should work. I can't see any reason why it wouldn't. And you'd still be able to pull it apart if you wanted to.
Yeah. I was thinking about just making up something 3D printed to kind of hold it together and then maybe do that with the...
What's the plastic material? What is the name
of
the plastic?
You can get a bunch of different ones. The one I was thinking about using is, it's called a PETG, P-E-T-G. I'd have to do my
research. You might look up, just look up something. If I'm not going to go to the board here. I'll type it in. It's called the dielectric constant. See if you can find the material and look up what's known as its dielectric constant. And see how many volts, it's expressed in volts. You know, so is it a 6 kilovolt? Is it 10 kilovolts? That's not going to be enough. You really need like 20 kilovolts, 30 kilovolts, or it'll still arc through it.
Okay.
So like regular electric black tape, like Scotch 33 Plus, is only good for like 600 volts or something like that. I see people trying to insulate their second anode wire with that stuff. It's like, what are you thinking? That's 600 volts. That's 35,000. So.
Yeah, you got to cut a couple more rolls around, right?
Yeah, at least a couple more rolls around.
James, is that a new high voltage diode you got there, or are you just trying
I tested it, and it's good by using the 9-volt battery, and I had the proper voltage drop through it.
Oh, really? Yeah. Oh, well, that's a good trick. I didn't think you could even pump any current through the high voltage diode at those low voltages. That's interesting.
Yeah, I saw something on YouTube or whatever, just testing high voltage. He was doing a high voltage for a microwave. And he was saying if you take the voltage drop through it, you put 9 volts through it, you can measure the drop on it, and then I'll tell you whether or not it's good. So I've tried that on a couple different ones, and then
I believe it's good. Oh, that's great. That's a great trick.
Google's been extremely helpful, and YouTube has been extremely helpful for me in learning a lot of what I've kind of come
up with. YouTube is so great. I had to replace the main bearing in my washing machine. The main bearing. I mean, it's the most difficult thing you can do. But I watched several YouTubes, and one guy, you know, had a cool trick on how to use a tire jack and a 2x4 to jack the bearing out of the, or jack the tub out of the washer, and this, that, and the other little tricks that I would never have figured out. I couldn't have done it without that instruction. No way. No way.
Yeah, I actually watched a YouTube video where the guy used a diode from an old microwave for an Asteroids, and he got it up and running.
Oh, well, I like that. I like that.
I guess I think if you have ballooning or whatever, then you know you got to go with a higher voltage diode. Right?
Wait. Paul and James were conflicted. Paul, what did you say? Sorry.
Some of the hobbyists have made aftermarket diodes for the Vector games, if any of you guys need them. Just do a search on Killer List of Video Games, and I can't remember who was reproducing them, but they are being reproduced at this time.
That's good. I think there's a few arcade shops that they still have. Wow, they sell the high voltage diodes. I think they're like $18 or something.
It's amazing. It's this reminds me of people that restore Model A's and Model T's and stuff like that. It's just like everything's available. It may be a replica part, and it would be, but you know, it's all there, whatever you want. So it's fascinating the way you guys are restoring. There's some beautiful restoration. Some people have done some, and some interesting people building their own cabinets, which is just, while we were taking cabinets to the dump, you guys are building cabinets. Just, oh my God. I pushed so many video games off the back of my truck into the dump. You know, they were stripped. It was just cabinets. You know, we strip all the good stuff out. But people were horrified by it. Even back in 1990, when I was doing it, people, before collecting was really popular, people were horrified. Oh no, it's burger time. No, you know. But we could never make a dime off of burger time. We couldn't. We just couldn't. You couldn't operate. Nobody
will. Oh, dedicated burger time is worth $1 now.
How much is it?
I'd say it's worth about $800 at least in the low end. And a dedicated cabinet with a, what is it? Peter Pepper was the guy on the cabinet. They had that screen of him on the side. That people like that stuff. People pay money for it.
I just don't $800
get it. $800 I'd say to go for if it's working.
Well, yeah.
It's also going to depend on where you are and what market. I know in Southern Ontario here, or Central Ontario, you're paying $1,200 for a good working game no matter what.
Well, if you wanted to get a game from the United States, would you have to pay import duty, James?
Yeah, and sometimes it's just prohibitive on the transportation costs. I think because a lot of the parts get made in Japan or whatever, that when they come across the border, I do get hit with duty or something like that. So I myself have only got one or two games, but I drove over and got it, and it came through and declared it, and they were pretty decent about it. So.
Oh, good. Well, that's good.
Yeah.
Okay, Randy, I got a question for you.
Yeah.
I get a lot of people send me chassis, mostly K7000s. They say they can't adjust the width. Mm-hmm. What they have been doing is they've taken an Allen wrench, sticking it in the coil, width coil, and destroying the ferrite core.
How do they not burn their finger? Because it'll get red hot.
They'll take them out before they install them, and they'll try and turn out the core, and they'll shatter the core.
Well, the core is a replaceable thing.
But where can I find them, man? I can't find them anywhere.
Oh, I've never looked for one. I've always taken them off of junk. You know, I've always had tons of junk. That's a great question. They gotta be available. If they're not available as cores, you should be able to buy old coils with the same diameter, and it'll have the same pitch thread. I would think. I really don't know. That's a great question.
Right now.
Wow.
You wouldn't believe how many people just, if the core is stuck in there, if you let it heat up for a while in the machine, it'll expand a little bit, the core, the width coil. Mm-hmm. Then you could gently try and unscrew it, and you might get it to break free. But when people jam stuff in there and try and just turn it, they just immediately scrap it. They destroy the core, and then you can't adjust your width at all.
Sometimes one of the tricks is to unsolder the whole thing and pull it out from the bottom. You know, just keep going through. Just pull it out from the bottom. And then you can clean it up and put some silicone lube or some graphite probably really on it and just stick it back in there.
I've tried uninstalling them using a heat gun and just a quick couple swipes with the heat gun just to heat it up and expand it. Yeah. That's worked a couple times. But if you do it too much, you'll melt the width coil right on your table.
Yeah, I think that when they originally built those, they used beeswax actually as kind of a thing, and then that beeswax evaporates, and then you don't have any lubricant.
Pretty sure that's how they built. But that's a part I'm on the lookout for.
Okay, I'll see if I can help you there.
I've seen people. Well, I've read articles about people rebuilding some of these old ones, like rebuilding new ones. If I find some more information, I'll send it to you, Paul.
Well, certainly rewinding a coil wouldn't be difficult. There's nothing to that. But actually physically making the whole thing with the slug, that's beyond my skill set, that's for sure.
They had some repros a few years ago back in the early 2000s, but they only made a limited amount, and now they're no longer available. So, hobbyists are really picky about everything on their monitor. They got a 40-year-old monitor that they want to look perfect. You know, from top to bottom, every line has to be perfect. I do my best, but, I can't build them a whole new, well, I can build them a monitor that'll look almost new. But
at one point when Wells Gardner was really cranking the monitors out, they weren't really very good. When you compare it to a Sony PVM or something like that, you know, it's just Wells Gardner quality. When you just put it up against a Polo, you put it up against a Hunter X Polo, and you see how crisp and gorgeous the Polo image is compared. But they use so many more parts in the Polo, and it's such a piece of crap. It's weird that the hardest thing to work on in such a terrible design produces the most excellent picture. It really does.
I think from an engineering point of view too, when they were designing these things, I don't think they anticipated that they would be lasting 40, 50 years or that people would be trying to keep them going that long, right? So the fact that a lot of these things are still around, I'm kind of impressed with. Like somebody,
it's a miracle. I applaud you guys. I really do. I just think it's amazing. Hey,
if I can share my screen just quickly, Randy, because I did find the electrical sheet here on that PEG stuff. So here's where you're talking about the dielectric constant, right?
Yeah, isn't it in volts?
It looks like it's
2.6 kilo. It's probably kilovolts.
There
it is, 16 kilovolts per millimeter dielectric strength. So, that should be plenty. You would just make it 3 millimeters thick, and you're good. Yeah. You're good to go.
So I was already working on my 3D model of it, and I was using 3 mils just on a gut feeling. So,
yeah. Oh, it's then perfect. Okay, perfect. Yeah. Hey, good. So sometimes we do the right thing. Amazing. Can I operate your screen? No, I can't. Can you? I'm just looking at an image, right?
I use two different ones. So if you use Teams, you can actually request a control, and then you can, but not on this one.
Am I still host, Paul? Are you still host, or did you give it away?
Yeah, I'm still host.
Okay.
I'm in charge right now.
I wish we had a bigger turnout. I was really expecting a dozen people. It's interesting. I mean, I'm glad you're here. Don't get me wrong. I'm super happy to see you. I just wish there was some more stupid people, I guess. I shouldn't say that.
No, I'm one of those guys. I just don't know what questions to ask at this point.
More novice people here. You know, several Randy, people said they were coming. Yeah.
Do you still do classes live or are you retired from that?
No, I would if I could, but with the COVID, you know, that's not happening. I've been in the casino industry and Like every year, I do a big educational convention for slot machine technicians called Tech Fest, where I give lectures and I invite the bill validator people to give their lectures on their bill validators, the ticket dispenser people give a ticket dispenser lecture, the touchscreen guys come talk about touchscreens, and it's really a great event. And also I go to, to mostly Indian country. I would go out to these, you know, Native American casinos all over the country and teach their slot department to, you know, how to fix LCD monitors and just general stuff. In general, I'm taking folks that really know nothing about electronics and making it so they're not scared to work on the stuff. So that, and we have a couple of projects we build. We build a component tester and some other stuff, and everybody comes away with soldering gear and tools and a tool kit and a meter. And so when they're done with the thing, they feel like, you know, real technicians. And some people really, really get it, and some people don't. And but it's a lot. That's really a lot of fun because I'm on the res a lot. And so it's a nice drive here in the Southwest. You know, I live in San Diego. So a drive to Arizona, a drive to New Mexico, maybe, or something like that. And, you know, spend a week at a Native American casino at their hotel and teach them. It's fun, really. Hey, well, listen, well, let's cut this one short then. Was that adequate? Are we adequate? For, you guys are all just my
friends. You're always adequate, Randy.
I did. I would like to just touch on my monitor I was working on.
Oh, okay, yeah, sure.
I'm just waiting for more parts. that's the one with the red vertical.
Oh,
reader,
yeah. Red so retrace. When you pulled the red transistor out and fired it up, was it still red?
So I never even got that far. I went and measured. I went and measured the voltages on the video output transistors
on the collector.
Yeah, on the neck board, okay. And they were all the same.
Oh, that's bad. Really, that points to a bad CRT, doesn't it?
Oh, okay.
Right. If all those voltages at the collectors are all nice and high, you know, at 125 volts or whatever they are, remember the lower the voltage, the more the gun turns on. If they're all nice and high and you see red on the screen, it really has to be a bad CRT. Now, why that is, we don't know. If it's a heater to cathode short, or something else. But when you're ready, I can talk you through it. We don't have to do it during the workshop. Just okay. Give me a call sometime, and you've got a camera there, and I'm happy to talk your way through it.
Okay, so being excited because all the voltages were the same, I brought my oscilloscope out, and I start to probe on that.
Okay.
And I'm usually pretty steady with my hand.
Oh, no.
However, I didn't have a proper hook on my test probe, so I, with my left hand, was holding it, and then with my right, I reached over the big tube, and I heard two hard buzzes, like they were shorting out. So it turned off, and then it wouldn't come back online. So then after a while, I plugged it back in. It came back online with partial vertical collapse.
Oh, how interesting is that?
So then I took the chassis out. I turned it on its side. I powered the unit back up again, and I started probing through. And the power supply was good. But then when I came to the secondary side of the power supply, the fast recovery diode for the... I think it's a 40 volt rate at 3 amps that failed. And it
shorted?
Was, it didn't short, but it gave me, like, I should have expected a volt, a junction drop of 0.4 to 0.7, right?
No, it's a high speed diode. You can expect a forward junction drop as little as 1/10 of a volt. It could be 0.1, 0.15 one way. As long as you get a reading one way and open the other, it's good.
Breaking up here for the first time.
Oh, okay. Let me go to the board. Let me go to the board. Standby.
But the other diodes were fine. They tested, and that was the unusual part. This particular one was testing unusual compared to the other fast recovery ones, though.
Oh, well, certainly, if you do a comparison test, if you do an A-B comparison test, and it's different from the other ones, which are all the same, you've proven it. I actually interrupted you. What was your reading on that diode?
Sorry, Randy, again, you're broken up.
I'm sorry.
I lifted I lifted the leg on all the other fast recovery diodes, and I believe I got like 0.1 or something. I'll have to go back and check it.
I mean, what you're looking for? Am I coming through here? Test. 1, 2, 3. No.
Yeah, you're kind of.
You're clear over here, and yeah, maybe it's John's connection.
John, you suck a lot. It's okay.
John's on.
That's okay. Oh, I'll see the recording if worst case.
That's right. Sorry, what you're looking for is what we refer to as the front to back ratio. That is to say, you should see a lot of conducting one way and no conducting the other. In general, in my experience is when the diode goes bad, it dead shorts. Wow, I'm hearing something weird. Andrew, is that you making noise? Hello, testing, or is it me? Hello?
No, I think Andrew joined in. There was some noise on his end. He muted his mic after.
Okay, cool. I'm still trying to figure out these different views here.
Quiet on this side.
Exit full screen. There we go. That's what I wanted to do. I can explain that thing about the high-speed diodes as long as we have a couple of minutes. Let me do that. So stand by. Let me just change cameras again. Hang on. I really am lame here. Sorry.
After his quick question, I maybe have one about, is there any chance to rewind a coil for a yoke coil or anything?
I would never attempt to rewind a yoke. I heard somebody mentioning about doing that successfully even.
Yeah.
That's way beyond my wheelhouse. That's way out of my...
I'm working on a couple of monitors for a buddy of mine. They're Sanyo XM1801s, and the coils are bad. And they're hen's teeth defined. So it's kind of like, well, what's your other option? Is to, do you look at recoiling it? Is that possible? Or
I've only seen a bad yoke once, and it was the bad horizontal coil, which is the ones that are on the inside.
This one gave us a trapezoid, and the colors went out.
Oh, that would be a bad yoke. Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, that's so surprising. Just quickly, as long as you mentioned high-speed diodes, let me just cover this. High-speed diodes. So as we all know, a regular diode, which looks like this, you know, it has one end, which is...
Sharp.
Am I coming through clearly? I'm hearing weird shit.
I think Paul's, you're clear to me, but I think Paul's kind of...
Paul, mute yourself. Mute your damn self. And then the other side is called the cathode, right? So anode and cathode. And they're made out of silicon, as you know, and it takes a certain amount of voltage to push the current through. And typically it takes around 6/10 of a volt, as you know. That's what's known as the forward junction drop of the diode. It's called the junction drop of the diode for reasons I'm not going to explain right now. It takes about 6/10 of a volt. And that's 6/10 of a volt. Yes, no. Yes, you can hear me? No, you can't. Man, I'm just hearing terrible audio. I'm hearing weird.
I can hear you fine, Randy.
Okay, everybody else mute, okay? Do me a favor, everybody else.
I was on mute, wasn't it?
Everybody else mute, all right? So, anyway, so that's a regular diode. Now, if I were to draw a graph of how this diode works, like this, and it's voltage in the vertical direction, remember volts. Right. So let's say that that's 1/10 of a volt, 2/10 of a volt, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7/10 of a volt, 0.7, 0.6, 0.5, 0.4, 0.3. Right. And if we look at like a regular diode, and remember, it's time in the horizontal direction. as the voltage increases, it won't start conducting until it reaches 6/10 of a volt. So 6/10 of a volt is that much time, however much time that is, I don't really care. Now imagine though that you had a special high speed diode, and a high speed diode, instead of having this junction drop of 6/10 of a volt, the junction drop, let's say, is only 2/10 of a volt. And the way they do that is in the manufacturing process, and we as technicians don't care how that works. So now as it rises, as the voltage rises and rises and rises, now when it hits just 2/10 of a volt, it starts to conduct. So it only takes this amount of time for the high-speed diode to conduct versus this amount of time that the regular diode conducts, and that's because it has this lower junction drop voltage. So when you test a diode, the diodes typically will test one of two ways. It'll either be about 0.6, 0.5 or so, a half a volt or so, with your meter set on diode test setting, of course, one way, and open the other. Or you might see a super low, it might even be a 1/10 of a volt. Like, for example, we have these dual diode assemblies, as you know. There are things that look just like transistors, but they're actually two diodes in one package. And I'm sure you've seen these things before. It might have a tab on it or whatever. It's a dual diode assembly. We use these, for example, for the plus 5 volt DC power supply, switching power supplies very often. It's one of these big high-speed diodes. It's sometimes called a Schottky diode. Anyway, when you test that, it's like 0.1 one way with your meter set on diode test and open the other. It's very, very low. But as long as you have this, again, it's called the front to back ratio. As long as it's conducting one way and not conducting the other, it should be a good diode. At least that's been my personal experience. Anyway, so that's that. You can unmute now. I hope that came through okay. I guess.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, it was clean here.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you, whoever that was.
James. James.
Were
you the one asking about the Sharp monitor, Sharp XM1801?
Yeah, yes, I was.
Paul, you know, I think it's you.
Right.
You know, Paul, your connection's messed up. Can you disconnect and reconnect? How hard would that be for you to do?
Yeah, he sounds like he's auto-tuned.
Yeah, yeah, it does. Yeah.
I can't. Yeah,
I can't hear you, Paul.
Hey, Randy, I'd like to disconnect.
Okay. Give me ultimate power then, or do I have it back anyway? I guess I probably do. No, I don't. Give me ultimate power back, Paul.
I don't like giving you the power back.
Yeah, thank you. Do that. It still says your host. Still says your host.
Still says.
I don't know how to do that. It says your bandwidth is low.
I don't know.
Just bail out. And I think we're probably going to call this a quits anyway. Yeah, let's just call it quits. Everybody okay? Have a happy day. Go out and enjoy yourself.
That's funny.
We win, which is really good. And I'm happy about that. Let's enjoy the day. All right.
If I could just ask Paul, if you want, you can DM me as well. If you're on Facebook or whatever, just to answer the question about the Sharp, I'd be curious to know what you were saying about that.
Okay. All righty then. All right. See you later, everybody. I guess, Paul, it'll be up to you to end the show since you're the host.
Yeah, because I got a solution for you.